Welcome back, everybody, to Game 2 of Dream Destroyers versus Sneaky Nick's Assassins. I have to admit, I did not expect I was going to be going into Game 2 saying that Dream Destroyers are going to be one game up. Honestly, I thought this was going to be a quick 2-0 in the favor of SNA. In fact, I actually am still thinking they'll be able to take Game 2, but all props to Dream Destroyers. Honestly, they pulled out a really good game in Game 1. We'll see whether or not they continue that trend. SNA certainly have some things to be working through. Ike's Mike's internet being one of them. But there were obviously a lot of other errors that were happening as well. So SNA definitely have some things to work around. But Dream Destroyers are going to be going in deep here in Game 2. They're going to be picking up Shadow Shaman, a Brewmaster, Death Prophet, and Faceless Void. Though goes to Sneaky Nyx Assassins. And that leads me to welcome in my co-caster, Nahaz, to talk about... What do you think, sir, about this 1-2 opening?
Well, the number one thing that I would have been shocked by if it hadn't happened was that Furion ban. That Sneaky Nyx Assassins, that with the very first ban, they immediately got rid of Bloody Nine's Nature's Prophet. He had played three completely different builds in the last four matches and played them all perfectly and won on that hero. And that you just got to make him play something else at some point. I love the Death Prophet and the Faceless Void combo. I think that that's – I actually like that better than the Vaunted Faceless Void and Skywrath Mage. TC plays an excellent Death Prophet. I've seen him really do extremely well mid on that hero, even against your Razors and your Vipers. Of course, both of them are banned out in this situation. And Dream Destroyer is going for something that actually looks a lot like the lineup that Sneaky Nyx Assassins had in the last game, opening up with that Shadow Shaman and Brewmaster. They're going to, of course, go with the Wraith King rather than the Alchemist.
Okay. I'm down with it. I'm really concerned about this 1-2 for SNA though. Like that's like one of the combos. That is like one of the meta defining hero combinations right now.
What's that? The Shadow Shaman and the Brewmaster?
No. The Death Prophet Faces Void combo.
Yeah. Yes. Yes.
It's dangerous. In the hands of SNA, I'm thinking it's going to be very dangerous.
I agree. Okay. I thought you were saying the other... when you said you were worried, I thought you were saying the other direction, but
no,
I agree.
I'm just worried the DD just left them like a really big opening to be able to pick up both those heroes. In general, I think the Death Prophet is so strong, but...
Yeah, I mean, to me, the question in this match is what hero will they pick up for Bloody Nine, and will he have the kind of game impact on that hero that he's been having on this Nature's Prophet? Because to me, he is absolutely, to say nothing of him being the drafter as well, he is absolutely the key to this team winning. That's no disrespect to Justin. We've talked in the last match about the plays that he's capable of winning and the kind of upside that he has as a player. But to me, this run that DD has been on has been completely cued by Bloody Nine's play on the Nature's Prophet, and they need to pick a hero for him that he can have that same kind of game impact on.
Dream Destroy. I do like the Wraith King pickup, and I'm actually kind of hoping they run a Wraith King core here just because the Wraith King core is really good versus both the Death Prophet and the Faceless Void. More importantly, up against the Faceless Void. But I'm thinking you're going to need that kind of extra blinking initiation while also being able to have a strong physical damage dealer that can afford to some targeted aggro and die once and come back. But maybe not. The Doom is now going to be picked up by Dream Destroyers. That now leaves me for support Wraith King, because I really don't want to see three different melee cores up against Faces Void, Death Prophet, both who exploit melee heroes pretty heavily.
Right, exactly. Now, I actually like the Wraith King. I like core Wraith King better on the dire side when you can stack him in a really strong aggro tri-lane. I like support Wraith King much more on the Radiant side where he can take advantage of that very farm-friendly jungle. But regardless, looks like it's going to be a support Wraith King here, and that's fine. I still am going to look for possibly an aggressive tri-lane coming out with that Doom farming solo in the top position, but we'll see. It looks like they were a little bit reluctant to pull the trigger on that one in the last few matches. The Brewmaster versus the Death Prophet mid, though, is certainly a nice matchup. I see that matchup as relatively even and coming down to room control.
SNA, they have picked themselves up really strong support to be able to pair with the Faceless Void, but we're still looking for probably another support and another carry, as I'm going to presume this Faceless Void is going to be run in the offlane. Don't really think you want to run a one-position Faceless Void up against these heroes and the Rubick being picked up by SNA, which is, I mean, he does have a lot of great abilities to steal, don't get me wrong, but... I'm still not sure if that's enough laning presence to be able to offset the Jakiro. I feel like there's a lack of damage coming from these two supports. We already have a lack of damage from your offlane hero.
Yeah, I mean, the one worry right now is that Faceless Void statistically has had a lot of success as a solo offlaner. He has not had the same great success in the carry position. It looks like DD are going to have a very strong defensive tri-lane if they want one. And that makes, even on the Radiant side, that makes a solo offlane Void a pretty difficult, you know, up against a Shadow Shaman and a Wraith King and a Doom, if they do choose to run it that way on that dire top lane, even the more favorable Radiant offlane becomes a tough proposition for that Void.
Yeah, it's mainly just the Shadow Shaman just being able to add in that long duration disable up against the Faceless Void. It could potentially be able to kill him before. Okay.
The sniper ban. Okay. That's not something you see every day.
Maybe they know. Maybe they know something about Dream Destroyers. Meanwhile, DD went ahead and banned away the Venomancer, core Venomancer.
Radiant team.
The offlane Venomancer, I guess. I'm not really a big fan of it.
You've got. I think in this current metagame, I think you've got to run Venomancer mid. I really do. Venom in 6-8-1 is I think he's 13-13 when run solo mid, and he has like a 35% win rate in all other lanes.
And then I guess we're left with a one position Death Prophet and offlane Faceless Void. I just can't say I'm that big a fan of one position Death Prophet too much, but.
Thing. I would have said the same thing, but again, it's hard to know what to make of these amazing plays by like Arteezy. But boy, away to Invokers. This can be a swap. Okay, they do have it. Okay, so they have swapped Mike out. Beat Kid is going to be standing in because of those internet issues. And so with the role swap, interesting. Way to is going to move into this Invoker. I think they probably put him, if I'm laning this, I put that Invoker solo safe lane, and I do run the aggro tri-lane around Degenerate's Faceless Void.
I can't say I'm a fan of that one.
I'm not necessarily a fan, but I think that's almost how you have to lane this in this situation. Just because you pick the Invoker, he just, never mind. Fluff is going to go ahead and go down with that Invoker. That's the thing. Invoker in any kind of tri-lane, I just don't like at all.
Okay.
That's basic. I mean, it's very. That's the thing. I mean, we can analyze and we can go in depth all we want, but you know, at the end of the day, they're gonna bank if they're gonna do what I think they're gonna do here and send the Jakiro and the Rubick bot. They're gonna bank on the fact that those two are gonna be able to get level two pulling the jungle and then maybe go and roam and try and gank the lanes, because you can't have two supports standing around when you have an Invoker in a lane. It's just, he needs that early XP so badly. And even maybe guaranteeing him that free farm and getting a good Midas time still, to me, is not worth the slowing down his early level progression.
Well, we'll see how they want to do it, because they're going to be kind of forced into this defensive tri-lane due to the fact that DD are apparently running an aggro tri themselves. Bloody Nine is going to be taking the one-position Wraith King here into the aggressive tri-lane so they can free up room for their Doom to be able to go solo somewhere. And it looks like he's going middle for a build, and Chobo is going to be going into the solo safe lane up against the Faceless Void. Now, that's a good matchup. And the Doom versus the Death Prophet, I'm assuming it's a matchup that they have practiced and they just know it works well. And I could see why. I mean, especially if you're going to go for a bottle build, there's more than enough sustain for Doom up against the Crypt Swarm Harassment. And you're just going to be able to get off a lot of levels thanks to a matched out power build.
How's he going to see it? I guess, okay, I mean, you CS with Devour? I don't know, man. That's against it, especially against an experienced player like TC on Death Prophet. I think this Doom's just going to get crushed.
Yeah, I mean, I think he's going to be able to pick up a decent amount of CS. I don't think there's much fear of the roaming because the Rubick and the Jakiro aren't really threatening roaming heroes, and they're also going to be locked down in this defensive tri lane. I think the Doom doesn't actually do that badly 1v1 up against the Death Prophet, as long as you're going for the fast bottle build. I'm not sure if you went for like a more fully invested build, you'd be able to pull it off, but I don't know. We'll see how it works for them. They're going to start off. Justin's going to eat one of the hard creeps first before he heads himself into the lane, and it's going to be a Hellbear Smasher. Not what
but even
wanted.
Even here, I hate this. I just hate giving anybody a free first creep wave in mid. I mean, especially because he's gone this greedy build with no talisman, two branches, and the two pooled tangos. Giving him that free first creep wave, and TC's a pro, man. He's going to be able to maintain the creep equilibrium right here in his own favor. I feel like this gets him his bottle up, and I feel like you've lost the lane even now.
Well, we're going to have a bit of a pulling here in the bottom lane. The Freedom Shadow Shaman is going to be pushed away. They do have a ward that's going to be blocking up the pull as it spawns at the two-minute mark, so they won't be able to do that pull anymore. Meanwhile, we have a rotation here. Rubick is actually going to be rotating from bottom lane all the way up to the top lane to try and ensure Degenerate has a little bit of an easier time while they're just going to have the Invoker being babysat by the Jakiro. Now, I think this is the right play, especially since Faceless Void could use the extra bit of laning presence, as well as the extra hero in the bottom lane obviously doesn't really help out the Invoker too much. This may also be able to give him some opportunities to rotate into the mid lane, but more than likely, a Rubick solo ganking isn't going to do that much for you.
Yeah, I mean, I think that really what it comes down to is that DD has the kind of tri-lane where they can easily contest those pulls, and so it becomes really, really dangerous to have your Rubick and your Jakiro, for both them and the Invoker, it becomes really, really dangerous to have them pulling and contesting up there in that jungle. But again, you know, TC already sitting on 12 and 10 in the mid lane here as the Doom is forced to go back up into that jungle. I don't know. I'm going to stop talking about it now because people are going to get sick of it, but I don't like this lane decision.
Chobo trying to go for Degenerate is going to be forced away. Still winning this matchup 1v2, but he does have to be careful. Takes away the health potion, and if they get a lucky time lock proc, Chobo maybe could have been in trouble.
Okay, nice ice path there.
Yep, Freedom still is going to be able to get a really good shadow wave, and the block is going to be able to ensure the first blood, and that is huge, Freedom. Being able to pick up that one, not only do they shut down way too sexy, back up to the top lane, Chobo will die, no passive, no evasion, he will be
dying. And that becomes an even trade. I mean, in fact, I might actually even say that they came out ahead on that one. Early kills on an offlane Faceless Void, even with the Rubick present, are just so huge.
You're going to see the Brewmaster. Once he comes back into lane, though, he has a huge advantage. Even though he did die, he basically blew all the regen there on the Faceless Void during those two engagements. So he's going to be forced all the way back to base. So it does suck they gave away that kill. He is also going to lose a lot of gold and experience due to his downtime. Now, an early support rotation from the smoked up Dazzle and Shadowed Shaman may come as a bit of a surprise to TC. As they're going to poke their head out, TC sees them and will be running himself up the river to make sure he doesn't get caught and back into lane. So failed smoke rotation, maybe caught TC by surprise there, but he was already in the right rotation upwards that he wasn't going to get caught.
Yeah, that's the thing. I mean, he's having such an easy time managing the lane equilibrium here. I mean, it's so hard to pull off those kinds of ganks when the creep wave is just always where your enemy mid wants it to be.
Top lane, we're actually going to have a teleport of the Shadow Shaman here, and they're going to return a dual lane with a dual lane and leave the heavy disabler to be able to try and go on the Faceless Void here. Now, he's going to come in. Time Walk should go off by Degenerate just in time, but they're going to turn onto Fluff and stuff now as Freedom holds him in, and the Sunstrike's going to be able to land on Freedom. They might be able to get a return kill. Fluff and stuff really gunning for it, but the Wand is going to be able to keep Freedom just above, and now Degenerate, unfortunately, with no Time Walk and just not anything else to be able to add into the fight. won't be able to ensure any deaths. So no surprise that the dual lane comes out in the favor of the Brewmaster once again.
Yeah, but this mid lane is just starting to be a disaster.
Well, Justin's going to start pushing out. Fortunately, Justin is really good anti-carry versus the Death Prophet. So
it's true.
If he is getting a lot of farm, hopefully they'll just try and focus him down. But it's going to require a Blink Dagger for him to be able to put a stop to that that Death Prophet. Because the last thing you want to do is doom up a Death Prophet after she's exorcism.
Yeah, he's actually, I mean, for all that said, he's actually doing better than I thought he would, right? He's going to hit his level 6 not that far behind TC. TC's only one full level ahead here. And the Invoker is really getting controlled very, very nicely down here in the bot lane. 8 last hits, only level 4 on an Invoker right now. That's the danger of the laning configuration that they chose. They might get dazzled here.
Yeah, he does have a Shell of Grave. He can... No! He
gotta hate that animation on
really
that spell.
Screwed that one up. Really screwed that one up. Because he used his teleport.
Yep.
So if he had just finished the Shell of Grave, actually used it, maybe he could have teleported away. But unfortunately, he just screwed up his commands, I guess. And
yeah.
Justin is about to pick up his level 6, so maybe we can see a rotation into the mid lane here sometime soon, as they do have enough mana with the Magic Wand proc, but they need some extra support. They need some sort of disabler to hold Death Prophet in, and unfortunately, they're just not getting that opening.
No, and that's the thing. I mean, she's already got her phase boots. Really nice move here by TC to finish the phase boots. You'll sometimes see the Death Prophet building straight into Drum or Yules before finishing those. But, I mean, just that's the way that she avoids the danger from this Doom. She knows that even if he does rush Blink Dagger, she's got some period of safety here where the Doom alone is not going to be able to kill her.
Bloody Nine, meanwhile, has been given some solo time here in this bottom lane as the two supports are going to be rotating out. Justin's farming up the jungle, and it looks like he's going to be doing that a bit more full-time as the Dazzle is going to get some love in this middle lane, while Shatter Shaman also does a lot of pulling in the top. They got the Wraith King basically to his reincarnation, and that's all they kind of needed to be able to do, and then they're going to rotate out. Interesting idea. But top lane, Chobo's going to be gone on. They do have that Chronosphere mixed in with the Sunstrike. They do need a little bit of extra damage, and that's going to come in from Fluff and South Rubik with that Fate Bolt. And it was enough damage to finish off that Brewmaster. Pretty critical kill there for the Faceless Void.
So, I mean, as we sort of start reaching the end of the laning phase here, DD has really done very well for themselves. The mid matchup didn't go as badly for the Doom as I was expecting. And then when you look at the side lanes, I mean, it's a laugher. Even with the kills on Brewmaster, he's doubling up Void in the CS race, and this Invoker is going to be very far behind, probably for the duration of the game, unless they can feed him a couple Sunstrike kills. Fluff gets doomed up here.
Yeah, Justin's trying to chase him down right now, but Scorched Earth is already out, and Squee is also going to be forced away, so that Exorcism did way too much damage to him. Fluff and stuff, easily going to be able to live through this one. Meanwhile, bottom lane, well, Bloody Nine was just doing a little bit of poking action, but Jakiro and the Invoker not really going to be able to add in enough damage. What the Invoker really needed was that kill on the Brewmaster. That's really what he needed.
Yes. Now, I was just going to say that if they'd have been able to find a way to get him that kill inside the Chronosphere, it could have made a huge difference, because right now, it is just, I have been an Invoker in these game situations too many times. It is just so hard to make an impact at level 5 at 8.5 minutes.
Yeah, and it's that general snowball where if you don't have enough levels to be able to kill somebody with the Sunstrike, that means you miss out on the kill experience and you stay low level and you stay doing very minimal damage with your Sunstrike. So that's the biggest issue for the Invoker right now. We'll see whether or not they can try and possibly clear up some room for him, as this Wraith King is just parked here in the bottom lane. He, like, is just not moving. DD are reading this and going, we're getting a lot better situation of this, because we basically have a jungler, thanks to the Doom with the maxed out Devour build. And so we are actually getting a lot of levels on our support in the mid lane. I would prefer to see the Shatter Shaman taking that support over the Dazzle, but it's neither here nor there. Both of them are going to be able to benefit from that kind of experience and be able to add in a large team impact, and they're still shutting down the side lane cores pretty effectively. I mean, every single time the Faceless Void comes forward, Chobo just immediately claps him, hits him a couple times, and Chobo is always forced away because he cannot win that battle up against a nuke plus the evasion chance. Now, B-Kid's going to be gone on by Bloody Nine, and there's a good chance he could actually get this kill with the second stun that's coming up in just a second. He finally gets it off. Now, Way Too Sexy does have a cold snap, but a quick critical.
What's he going to do? Yeah.
Finishes off the Chikiro. Top lane. Degenerate's being gone on right now. They do have the Storm Panda that's going to be able to throw somebody up in the air sometime soon, hopefully. He doesn't get the Shadow Shaman at any point in time. Now, Degenerate is still sitting here trying to get the time walk out. Does get it. Now, Freedom gets a really long shackle, but it's going to be interrupt by the cold snap. Now Chobo teleporting himself away. Freedom is going to be left to die as that's last second. They also managed to get the dazzle there inside of the pit. So
yeah, that was almost the turnaround that Way Too Sexy needed. That deafening blast was just a half second away from canceling the Brewmaster TP, and that would have been a huge sequence of events. The kill on the level 8 Brewmaster, you can already see, you know, Invoker got quite a bit through of the way through level 6 there. That would have gotten him a good chunk of the way through level 7 and back to possibly being in this game. But to me, I mean, the all you need to know about this game was told by Bloody Nine's Wraith King just farming away in the Radiant Jungle, not worrying at all about the consequences, and the Jakiro comes up and tries to contest him, and he says, okay, I'll kill you. What's your level 5 Invoker going to do to me?
Yeah, I'm really reading this as the draft here from Dream Destroyers is, and their laning phase decisions and everything else, is basically taking a look at, okay, that was a big mistake. Feeding away the Rubik, the Brewmaster Ultimate, but either way, oh, hold on. Chobo going to be initiated on. Of course, the Rubik is going to use that ultimate up against Chobo. Sunstrike does a good amount of damage extra. Lady Nine's going to come in, but immediately gets thrown up in the air. And Chobo is actually going to turn and fight this a little bit. And he may be regretting that decision as he's going to go down as the Storm Spirit Panda is able to get in that good amount of extra damage. Fluff and stuff may die, but he basically won a fight against three different cores on the side of Dream Destroyers. That is perfectly fine by him.
Oh, and just, I mean, exceptional play by Fluff there. That's the kind of trade that, oh!
Jesus, Freedom, that
so
should have been his.
It really should have been. The text from the Liquid Fire gets the tower kill. Oh, my.
Squee
disgusting.
Also got picked off in the bottom lane where he was held in by the Chronosphere and dunked by Way Too Sexy's all of his abilities, but still, that was a very simple, silly play there at the top lane with the Brewmaster feeding away the Rubik, and those kind of mistakes are just silly because I think Dream Destroyers have done an excellent job exploiting the obvious weaknesses in SNA's draft. When you run for both the Death of Prophet and the Faceless Void, those are two heroes that do very little in the first 15 minutes of the game, oftentimes.
And Invoke. And Invoker as well. I mean, that's the thing. And the worry for me is that they've squandered a bunch of this window that they bought themselves. Bloody Nine going down here would be catastrophic to their chances.
Yeah, TC's going to pop the Exorcist immediately on the second life. He is going to get stunned up, but Bloody Nine has no chance of being able to make it out of here. And a second silly play there from Dream Destroyers, who are really destroying their own dreams with these fatal misplays. Now they're going to go on TC and might just have enough to pop him real quickly. Brewmaster pops the ultimate. Support does go down, but they get a critical kill and are now going to keep on going with the pandas. Okay, start controlling the pandas sometime soon. Hopefully they back themselves up and Dream Destroyers will successfully get themselves out and shouldn't be sticking around since the Faceless Void is going to be having an ultimate sometime soon. But they exploited the first 15 minutes of the game by running strong lanes that it really took advantage of the lack of movement from SNA and the lack of an early laning presence by going for Midases, which are not going to be punished very easily because by the time SNA are ready, those Midases have kind of already paid for themselves. Not necessarily in gold, that takes a while, but in levels as well.
You have two heroes that can afford to go for the Midases, but here's the thing, right? You do such a good job drafting and in the laning phase, giving yourself that window where you have an advantage. It just, the frustrating thing about Dota, though, it doesn't take that many mistakes. It doesn't take that many silly plays to slam your own window shut. And I feel like that's what they did. I mean, you see Weichu's Invoker now has his Midas. He's getting on toward that level 9 where he'll have double Forge Spirit. Well, no, he's not going to have double Forge Spirits up. He's gone in kind of an unusual build. Oh, initiation in the Chronosphere. Justin's in trouble.
Yeah, he does have a Shallow Grave available to him, and he also has the mech, so he's going to be fine for the time being. Clap is just going to zone away the rest of the heroes of SNA, and not really the initiation they wanted to see there. As the Chronosphere being down may actually limit them. The Death Prophet Exorcism is coming up, but without the Chronosphere, I'm not quite so sure they can really take this fight, even with the Brewmaster Ultimate being down. But I 100% agree with you. You may be increasing your own levels with the Midas, but if you die, you're also feeding away a bunch of experience to the enemy team.
Yeah, I did not see that Justin had, I did not see that Justin had completed his mech just before that fight, and so he was fine there. He was really never in any real danger. But they're going to, this is very smart by DD. If they can finish off this Roshan here, this is a big swing in their favor.
Yeah, I don't think it'll be a problem either. They already have two heroes top aggressively pushing in this tier one tower because they realize, hey, if we focus some attention up here, they're not going to get us. Now, TC does see them. It's going to pop the Exorcism and try and go for freedom. And the Roshan's getting low, but they need to fight TC. It's not low enough. They're fully going to commit, but TC gets turned around. Doom shackled up underneath the wards will be falling. That being said, Bloody Nine and Justin are both kind of trapped inside the pit. They don't have enough power. Top lane, we have the Brewmaster operating his ultimate and will be able to take down the Rubick with massive amounts of prejudice, as he did steal that ultimate last time. Back to B-Kid, who's trying to get away from Bloody Nine, but that's not going to be happening, as a couple of right clicks is all it takes to be able to finish him off, and the tier 1 tower going down in the top lane. A very, very good, fortunate series of events here for Dream Destroyers, as they probably jumped themselves up probably at least a good 2,000 gold and 2,000 experience.
So you gotta forgive me, it's been a bit of a long day, but oh, okay, we're gonna get Degenerate going on top here. He looks like he will get away, but did TC know that they were in the Roche pit?
Maybe he didn't. I think he actually didn't know.
I think he might have just been chasing into that Roche pit without any idea that two more heroes were in there doing Roshan, because, I mean, otherwise, how do you explain the decision to just go right in? And he may be in a good deal of trouble here as well.
Yeah, the rotation in from Chobo is going to be able to get the clap on him. TC is super fast, though, and he does have the Yule Scepter. He's going to toss the Doom up in the air. Counter rotations are not going to be in time. Faceless Void does have the Chronosphere up, but they don't have an Exorcism to be able to capitalize on it, and they need to make sure they start getting those timings together. The worst thing you can do is go for a Chronosphere here, miss out on that kill, an Exorcism kill, miss out on that kill, and then always be off sync because of what you've just been too greedy and looking for those kills and not making sure you have the overwhelming power of both of those ultimates combined.
Now, we saw that in an earlier game from Navi US where they drafted a very team fight heavy lineup and just never really got off all the spells in one fight like you want to. I do like this from DD, though, with the Aegis on. They're just going to go ahead and make the push here.
Yeah, why not the four-man Chronosphere? Beautiful. They're going to try immediately go for the Shadow Shaman. He already dropped his wards, though. That's not bad. The Crypt Swarm is also going to be able to finish off Bloody Nine soon, or at least his first life. That's just the reincarnation. Wards are going to be taken down soon. It looks like almost Dream Destroyers backing themselves up, or at least has to clean up the enemy Serpent Wards that were stolen first, as that four-man Chronosphere just completely eliminated what should have been a quick and easy team fight for them. I mean, they're so far ahead, I feel. And especially after that last engagement, they also had the Aegis for the Wraith King. There really should have been nothing stopping them from claiming that tier 1 tower, except for the fact they grouped up and let their support die. Way too sexy. He's going to be doomed up in the bottom lane, and Justin is just going to walk it out. That's all he needs to do is he just needs probably one more right click, and it'll guarantee Way Too Sexy ticks out.
Oh, that hurts.
Yeah.
Void's going to try and make something happen here.
He's got Scorched Earth coming up, and if he can get some bottle charges in between, yeah, he's definitely good. Because that also means he could get some mana for his mech. That's going to be fine, and the middle lane also means Tier 1 tower is going to fall against two supports who don't even have, like, Serpent Wards. They're just right clicking.
It's been a nice game by Flops Rubick so far. Already gotten Primal Split attack and Mass Serpent Wards, and now has Thunderclap. I mean, he's played very, very well, but as you see, DD able to force the action here on multiple fronts, already threatening the Tier 2 bottom tower as well.
Yeah, they may lose the Brewmaster, but they're going to get a Tier 1 in exchange for the Tier 1 that's taken top, as well as get the Invoker and push in the bottom Tier 2, and probably lay in a good amount of damage, because you could see Bloody Nine, he's not messing around with his build. He is just fallen into so much gold recently, he's going to go for a rather early Radiance.
Wow, that is... I certainly can count on one hand the number of times I've seen that on Pro Play. I think I've actually only seen it once before. That's nuts. And I, you know what? It kind of makes sense in this game. I don't believe I just said that.
I think Radiance on several levels does make sense on a Wraith King, but in general, there's often better builds because you need to be a little bit more combat-oriented. But they seem to be really trying to stall this game out because they read SNA and they go, well, they may have a Faceless Void, and they're running this whole entire team fight strat, but just because they have a Faceless Void doesn't mean we can't take the late game, because it's an offlane Faceless Void. He's a hero that's not going to be starting off with good farm, and we can always stay way ahead of him in farm if we just control the map really well, out-farm him, and then we have the Midases kicking into play as well, which are be able to give us a huge advantage, and they're just going to keep on building on that as the Radiance is picked up by Bloody Nine now. It's going to be flown out to him in a second.
That's crazy. I mean, the thing is, to me, it has a lot to do with the fact that you're on the Dire side in this matchup, that I ordinarily think that giving the Aegis to Wraith King is not such a great thing, because generally, if you're going to die twice in a fight, you're probably going to die three times. But all of a sudden, three lives with a Radiance, if he can get one more tank item on top of that, is just scary. Because that's a lot of sustained damage.
He needs to die, though. Like, he really needs to die. Reincarnation is your first death, not your Aegis. You have a minute to die twice in a row. I don't think that's happening. So, Bloody Nine, he's going to try and play pretty aggressively here and take this tier 2 with the Serpent Wards next to him. Stun on the B-Kid, but that's just to give him time to right-click the tower some more. They're going to try and go for a deny here. And Ice Bath, well played, but unfortunately not well played enough as the Shadow Shaman Wards actually secured it.
Yeah, and there's no reason for him to spend his reincarnation here. It's not level 1, so the cooldown isn't ridiculous, but you know, still no reason to waste it.
Yeah. It's too bad you can't just like switch it out somehow.
Yeah. You know? And Wait's just going to go down again down here. Oh, this is devastating.
No. Justin gets him with the Blink Dagger, man. The Blink Dagger Doom. It is so powerful this game.
Yeah, it really is.
Death Prophet,
really is.
Invoker, these heroes, if you can jump before they're able to respond, they don't do anything.
And that's the thing, that ordinarily, you know, the way that you try to deal with a Doom, right, is make him have too many heroes for him to Doom in one fight. Oh, this is a big kill on Trobo's Brewmaster, though.
Yep, they're going to easily get him. Degenerates is in need of that kind of pickoff, too, as I think he almost has to build straight damage. I don't think this Mithril Hammer can go into a BKB.
No, I don't think so either, but here's the thing, right? The difference is that Brewmaster already has the Blinkin' of Vlad's up. He already has what he needs. The Invoker is sitting only on Necro 2 and Midas here at 22 minutes. You know, this is... ideally, this is the time where you'd already have your Necro 3 completed and be on the way to your next item. The difference is big between a kill on that Brewmaster, who already has basically what he needs to contribute, and a kill on this Invoker, who's still desperately trying to crawl his way back into this game.
Yeah, well, 100%. The Brewmaster was slightly higher level, but I think that's making a very little difference. His Faceless Void was... already, he's kind of getting to the point where you kind of need gold and not necessarily levels anymore. As you already hit your level 2 ultimate. Your next big upgrade is at level 16, unless you're just getting really boosted in experience. These extra levels aren't really going to make that big a difference, because that backtrack may not serve you any good. Those levels in that may not serve you any good if Doom is actually initiating on you. He may choose to do that. I mean, it's not that out of the question that if you see the opportunity to jump the void and you don't see the Death Prophet opportunity, yeah, go for it.
And but I'll tell you whose levels do make a difference. And that's that Bloody Nine, Justin just hit level 16 on his Doom, and Bloody Nine is about to hit level 16 on this Wraith King, who's gone Blade Mail after the Radiance.
Degenerate. He was halfway. He was doing a little airwalk in there, man. He was time walking halfway through that animation. And all of a sudden, Justin pulls out a "You're Doomed." And animation gets completely canceled. Fluff and stuff in some trouble. Freedom trying to get close enough for the shackles. Doesn't matter. Bloody Knight's got this under control. And he's just going to keep on going. Meteor over the top. But guess what? Blade Mail. Beak hit in some trouble. Brewmaster also going to pop his ultimate as he keeps on going. Next for the Invoker. In the background, we did have TC going for the two supports. The two cores are going to turn around and face TC. As he does have a heart as well as a Yule Scepter, he can take this kind of aggression. Up against Bloody Nine, he will eventually take him down. That's reincarnation number one. Now the clap goes off. Can they finish off? There goes a nice little Yule Scepter. The Exorcism is going to be bringing back a lot of health for TC, but he still gets taken down by the nukes just before the ghosts were on their way back. And now Bloody Nine has a full up regular old Wraith King build with an Irradiance on top. He's got a Blink Dagger as well as a Blade Mail. He's ready to initiate with the rest of his team.
And let me take a minute, because what frightens me about that is that DP already had her heart up. That's with a heart up. That he's able to just face rush the Death Prophet.
16-14, 25 minutes in. I can't believe I'm about to say it, but it looks like Dream Destroyers in a really good position to be able to take this 2-0 against SNA. Now, the Roshan is going to be up soon. I think that's really the last ticket here for Dream Destroyers. There isn't really anything else they need.
They know because of the Sunstrike, but I don't see how they're going to contest this. This would be one of the bigger upset results I have seen in quite some time. And I know, you know, it's NA Dota, crazy things do happen, but still, I would. Good thing I didn't bet my rares on this one, folks, because I would have been quite a bit poorer.
Yeah, Justin is actually going to be the one picking up the Aegis. There we go.
Yep.
It's always dangerous to just, like, the enemy team does know when somebody picks up the Aegis. It's always a little dangerous just to leave it out there for so long. I'm just waiting for somebody to actually be close enough or invis or smoked up and they blink in and steal the Aegis just because you're dinking around with your TP scroll.
Yeah, and I'm looking through the items on the side of Sneaky Nyx Assassins, and I just don't see what is going to be able to bring down DD fast enough. They just have so much sustain and so much sustain both in their tank ability and in their damage.
And that's why Sneaky Nyx Assassins.
This is what they have to do.
They gotta smoke up, push out, see if they can get a pick off on somebody. Unfortunately, this is the wrong position. Well, maybe with Fluff and stuff leading on a Telekinesis to follow up Chronosphere, they'll get the pick off on Chobo, guaranteed. And nothing of value is really gonna be picked up here from Dream Destroyers, besides an Ancient Stack, it looks like. As I really thought they were just gonna 5-man after getting that Aegis. I don't think they need anything else to be able to end this game, quite honestly.
And Bloody Nine's living life on the edge. Yeah, he really is. I mean,
it's 60-second cooldown, so I mean, and I guess they're not fighting until the Brewmaster's up anyway, so it's not like it matters.
But that's true, but I mean, there is this thing called the Sunstrike. I mean, that's okay.
Yeah, heals come in. Still, though, I
am so impressed, by the way, with what Justin's been able to do on this Doom in this match. That was just such a tough mid lane, and I mean, I thought he would get abjectly crushed. He was able to at least hold his own, but man, he has just been making plays all over the map. I mean, their team, you know, Sneaky Nyx Assassins has just had to live in terror of this Doom because he can pick any one of them off, and probably any two.
All right, so what are the last items here? Like, and for me, I'm always looking at it. I always look at the game as being very objective-based, especially in this current meta, and going, okay, if I'm not pushing right now, what is it do I need? Why am I not putting pressure on the enemy? Is it because we're not ahead? Is it because we're trying to buy time? And here, it's obviously neither the case. It's just waiting on certain items. And I'm not entirely sure what that is. I guess Chobo needs his Aghanims, I suppose, though I'm not sure that's necessary.
You'd want an Aghanims on your Brew. You would want to at least think about a BKB on your Wraith King, or maybe an AC. Doom already has his Shivas up. I mean, that's kind of the thing, that both of them are sitting around that 3,500 gold mark, where it's like, okay, I already have this much. Maybe just another item.
Oh, blink away there. Beautiful blink from Justin is going to be able to ensure that the Wraith King is going to be the only loss there in that Chronosphere. Now Bloody Knight pops his Blade Mail, and he almost goes down a second time. Meanwhile, the Doom on Degenerate is going to be able to finish him off as he will tick out there. The Exorcism is going to push back the rest of these heroes. The Invoker does deny the Faceless Void in the end. And the Tier 2 should be low enough, especially with that Exorcism time fading, that they will be able to lay claim to this one. Nothing was really lost. They learned in Reincarnation and Serpent Wards, but that is it. They still have the Brewmaster Ultimate. The Doom was used, of course, to kill the Faceless Void, but they got 30 seconds to push this in and try and force the down a Tier 3 tower.
Yeah, and they've got the damage right now that they can take this out fairly easily. I mean, that's the thing. If Reincarnation wasn't enough, how about Shallow Grave?
Yeah, for sure. Blade Mail being activated by Bloody Nine, sits on the front lines. He's got another 8 seconds, so he doesn't want to be getting too low for fear of being bursted. but he will be having up a second life for this next team fight. Justin goes in a little deep with the Shivas, trying to force back some of these heroes as they start going for that melee Rax. Now, Bloody Nine's going to lose his life here soon, but he does have a second one, but it doesn't look like they want to commit. Instead, they're going to back themselves up. They got a lot out of that, and I think one of the biggest things is they just need level 16 on the Brewmaster, and they'll have another significant upgrade with both the Ags and a level 3 ultimate being picked up around the same time. That is a very, very gigantic increase in your team fight power.
Yeah, and the other thing that I really like about that push is, you know, even over and above the objective, the tier 3 tower that they were able to take, and of course about half damage on the melee racks, which will regen right back up, but it's just the pressure that you put on the Void and on the Invoker just make it that much more difficult for them to be able to farm themselves back
perfect.
Into the game. Oh, not quite. Lucky time
this
walk,
time.
My goodness.
This
you got
time,
it this time. Yep.
There's no air walking for Degenerate. He's done with that. He's just barely able to get himself away. But Aegis is going to be going down in the next minute. I still can't believe they really haven't been using these Aegises. That's twice now that an Aegis is just going to time out rather than them fully committing to taking this. I can understand playing carefully. I almost think they're playing too carefully, though.
Well, it's one of those things that I think you in this situation you're pretty carefully watching the progress of the Void and the Invoker. It's pretty clear to me that TC's Death Prophet's not going to be able to carry this game alone, and so you're pretty carefully watching the item progress of the Void and the Invoker, and you're saying, okay, well, they're not building anything. Those items are not arriving. We're farming faster. We're ahead and we're farming faster on them. So, you know, being a little conservative, I don't hate it. I certainly would have liked to see them commit to something by now, for sure. But I don't think this is a case where by sitting back and farming, they're squandering their lead.
Yeah, that's true. I don't think they're losing ground necessarily.
Right.
I don't think that they have a better shot at winning the game now than they do 5 minutes from now.
Exactly.
Sometimes you have that, right? Where teams just kind of hold on to this lead. But 5 minutes from now, that lead isn't going to be as strong. Even if they pick up certain upgrade items, the enemy team is able to pick up something a little bit more important, a little bit more impactful. Well, that's really not the case here for SNA, as they have been routinely picked off. And the only bit of gold they're really holding on to right now is Way Too Sexy's 3,200, and that's still not enough for an important luxury item that could change the game like a Scythe of Ice. So the double refresher was picked up by Doom, and that is, huge to say the least, because we're already talking about how the Doom shuts down the three different cores. If you have the initiation, now he's going to be able to shut down two out of three of them.
Yeah, and that's the thing. I mean, boy, I just don't see how Sneaky Nyx Assassins wins a fight without a serious mistake. They're going to smoke up two here, DD, and really try to force the issue. This might be the death push that you've been waiting for, my man.
I think so, too. They're going to lead it with a pickoff. Whatever they can find, TC will do just nice.
Pickoff, too.
Yeah, that's perfect. So they go ahead and blow a Doom on him. Fine by them. There's going to be a buyback on TC. That being said, there's going to be another Doom for Justin.
Yes.
It looks like he's going to try and hold on to it, but he's probably going to be forced into a refresher, and he'll only have one Doom for the next team fight.
That's fine. I mean, you got the pickoff that you needed here, because that means that if you can initiate again on that Death Prophet and get her down, the game's basically over.
Radiant's top barracks push down to the top lane. We're going to have Dyer's some of these heroes be returning. They were trying to split push where they could.
Well, I think she's got a buy.
Yeah, I think so too. Okay. Bloody Nine is going to be jumping in pretty deep here, almost finishing off Degenerate. Just one of those crits. BKB going to be activated. The rest of the team needs to start focusing the buildings. There goes a Glyph. And so far, SNA has done a really good job making sure, but TC is now going to be in some trouble. Exorcism has already gone out. Bloody Nine is going to be held inside the Chronosphere. Oh, he's actually still hitting him. He was outside of it. Kills the basis Void. Oh my god,
That
blade mail just ripped through everybody, and you're right. It is just cleanup time from here. Dream Destroyers have just successfully gotten themselves into the MSI Beat It Global US Qualifier Finals up against Navi US.
I don't believe it. This is amazing. This is as big an upset as I've seen in quite some time. And what plays? I mean, this isn't a throw by Sneaky Nyx Assassins. This is a case of DD having their draft together, having their strategy together, winning the laning phase, and then leveraging that advantage. This is just beautiful Dota by them, and I'm really impressed by what we've seen from this team here tonight.
Yeah, that's going to be at least two racks down. SNA will still hold on for one more team fight because they know the third set of racks is not going to go down. Nope, TC is now going to call it.
Wow.
They read it as just being too much, and they go ahead. Very well done, Dream Destroyers. I got to say, I was walking into this series, I was not expecting this at all. I thought there was maybe a 5-10% chance they would actually be able to take out SNA, but they did it, man, and they did it in style, too.
You're not kidding. I mean, Bloody Nine, the impact player for this team in this game and in the last, has zero professional wins on record outside of this event. But he has brought it in this kind of an event. I think we might be seeing a star born before our very eyes, but these were some fun matches. Thanks as usual for all of you tuning in. We really appreciate it. The chat was awesome tonight. I actually learned quite a bit about these two teams during the chat in between games. So special shout out to you guys. We really appreciate it, and always a pleasure to cast with you, my man.
Yeah, thank you, man, for joining me and helping me get through these games in the very, very wee hours of the morning. And, of course, thank you to you guys for tuning in. We are going to be back up on Join Dota Red. There's currently a rebroadcast that is going on. It's going through all WEC, all the games that have been going on the last couple of days in preparation for the finals. And that's going to be starting at 10:30 CEST, I believe. So that is going to be your next broadcast, Join Dota Red. So be sure, you'll definitely want to be able to see that. That is just in 5 hours and 13 minutes for those guys who don't want to deal with time zones. So if you want to stay up a little bit longer, WC is sure to be one hell of a match. Cloud9 facing up against Evil Geniuses on a Chinese stage. All right, I'll take that any day. And then after that, I believe after WC, depending on what happens, because it's going to be 2 best of 3s in a row, there's a chance it could be a very, very long day of WEC. But if it ends up ending a little bit early, we are going to be doing a casual talk Dota. If you guys haven't seen that, that is a new thing that Toby and I are doing. We sit here in the cast. We get some of you guys, subscribers, calling in, asking questions, and we just go through. And of course, Toby and I are both very long-winded. We end up going on side tangents, so we end up getting a lot to talk about a lot. So if you guys are interested, you have specific questions about anything that has gone on recently you want to ask Toby or myself about, we will answer your questions. So that's going to be happening, as well as tomorrow after that. We also have ESL, another match that is going to be going on tomorrow afternoon after WEC. And that is going to be happening at 18 CEST. That's going to be Team Secret versus MYM. Sure to be a fun little match. And that'll be just a best of three. So that's your matches for your upcoming day at Dota Capitalist, at Nahaz Dota for your casters. And we will see you guys, 5 hours and 15 minutes.